So today we're here with our lovely patient, RB, who has systemic sclerosis. And today I'd like to review a few topics regarding the disease systemic sclerosis, and we'll do a physical exam to demonstrate some of the key findings, physical findings. So first of all, I want to differentiate between systemic sclerosis, which is obviously a systemic disease, from localized scleroderma, which is a disease that just affects the skin. The other term for localized scleroderma is morphea, and there are various forms of localized scleroderma, but those patients typically do not have Raynaud's phenomenon and do not have internal organ manifestations and typically do not have associated autoantibodies. The other differentiation I want to make is within systemic sclerosis. So there are two major subsets. There are patients with limited systemic sclerosis and those with diffuse systemic sclerosis. Both forms can have internal organ involvement, autoantibodies, and associated Raynaud's phenomenon. However, the difference between limited and diffuse is based on the extent of skin tightening. So patients with limited skin tightening or limited systemic sclerosis have skin tightening that involves only distal areas of the body. So the areas that can be involved are anywhere elbow distally, the face, and knees distally. Whereas in patients with diffuse disease, they're differentiated from limited by having any truncal involvement and any upper arm and upper leg involvement. So those are the two major subsets. So now I'd like to go on and talk a little bit about the classification criteria of systemic sclerosis. So as primary care physicians, you'll have a lot of patients coming in with Raynaud's phenomenon. And you might want to look out for some of these extra features to see if the patients might actually have systemic sclerosis, which is present in about 90% of patients with systemic sclerosis. So Raynaud's phenomenon actually is part of the classification criteria. And just to mention, you need 9 points to meet the classification criteria for systemic sclerosis. And you automatically get those 9 points if you have skin tightening involving the fingers, called sclerodactyly, plus any skin tightening proximal to the MCPs. So if you have sclerodactyly plus skin tightening of the hand, you automatically get the diagnosis or classification of systemic sclerosis. If you have skin tightening on other areas of the body, excluding the fingers, then you should be thinking of something else. So finger involvement is key. Now, going back to other ways that you can meet classification criteria for systemic sclerosis, getting those 9 points. So I mentioned Raynaud's phenomenon. Raynaud's phenomenon alone gives you 3 points. If you have sclerodactyly, that is skin tightening of the fingers where it is taut and difficult to pinch, and you often get this kind of shiny appearance of the fingers and loss of hair. That is 4 points. Now, believe it or not, you can actually just have puffy fingers and get points for this diagnosis. Puffy fingers gives you 2 points. It's a very common early sign of patients with systemic sclerosis, and they often come in with Raynaud's phenomenon, puffy fingers. So look for that when you see a patient with Raynaud's. The next criteria that you can get points for is nail fold capillary changes. So we use these fancy instruments in our dermatology clinics and rheumatology clinics that are called dermatoscopes. And they give you a 10 to 20x magnification, and you're looking at the nail folds for dilation of the capillaries or areas of dropout or abnormal capillaries called bushy capillaries. So you're looking just proximal to the cuticle. And that's the nail fold capillary area. So if you have abnormal nail fold capillaries, any of those changes I described, you get 2 points. And also that includes cuticular hemorrhages, I should mention. So another way you can get points is by looking at the digital tips. And I'm trying to see, did you ever have digital ulcers? So he may not have any digital pitting scars, although it looks like there might be some changes. If you can zoom in right here, that looks like a digital pitting scar. And it's basically representative of digital ischemia or lack of blood flow to the digits. So digital pitting scars gives you 3 points on the classification criteria. A lot of patients, at least 50%, get actual open digital ulcers that are very painful. And that gives you 2 points if you see that on physical exam. So do you mind pulling down your mask for a second? I'm looking for evidence of telangiectasias.
I had a couple of them.
And he does have their what we call matted telangiectasias. And we differentiate them from kind of the spidery, sun-induced telangiectasias, which have little legs. These are matted and pinpoint oftentimes. So telangiectasias gives you 2 points on the classification criteria. You can put your mask back on if you like.
Thank you.
So the last two criteria that you can get points for are having lung disease associated with systemic sclerosis, which can be either interstitial lung disease or pulmonary hypertension. And that's why we screen for both of these with annual pulmonary function tests, annual echoes, and high-res CTs if necessary to diagnose ILD. The last area is autoantibodies. So the scleroderma-specific antibodies that are most common are the anti-SCL70 or anti-topoisomerase. They're the same, interchangeable. Anti-centromere antibodies and anti-RNA polymerase 3 antibodies. If you have any one of those antibodies, you get 3 points. So that's the classification criteria.